please remain risen and join me in the call to worship that's found in our worship guide. Like a rushing wind that sweeps away all barriers, come, Holy Spirit. Like tongues of fire that set our hearts aflame, come, Holy Spirit. With speech that unites the babble of our tongues, come, Holy Spirit. With love that overlaps the boundaries of race and nation, come, Holy Spirit. With power from above to make our weakness strong, come, Holy Spirit. Amen. You may be seated and invite Pastor Casey for our children's message.
Thank you, Pastor TC. Hi, friends. My name is Reverend Casey Van Atta Casebeer. I am an associate pastor and director of family ministries here at Foundry. And I want to invite some kids, if we have any kids in the house that want to come down for the children's message, hi. And I'm going to invite our confirmands to come down too. We've got a dinosaur. Are you a dinosaur? What are you today? We're loving this. We're loving this. Hi, welcome. Oh yes, come right up here and join us. Confirmands, take a seat right here. Do you know what today is in the life of the church? Pride Month? It is Pride Month in the life of the church. Amen. Amen. Do you know what else today is and why we're all wearing red? Do you know what it's called? It's called Pentecost Sunday. Pentecost, very good. Oh yeah, well, we listen to our dads, right? And so today is Pentecost Sunday, and it is the birth of the church. And Pastor Ginger is gonna talk to us a little bit about what that means. And it's not just a birthday party, Pastor Ginger's gonna say. You know what it is? It's kind of a revolution. And so our young people are here as confirmands, and they are going to come into full membership of the church on today, on Pentecost, for this exact reason. And they're not ready, they're not just ready to begin a revolution, they're ready to join one and to carry it forward. And they're not gonna do that. They're not gonna do that 10 years from now, they're not gonna do that 20 years from now, they're gonna do it today. And they will lead us if we let them, amen? All right, let's pray. God, we are thankful for the gift of your Holy Spirit, for the gift of these young people, and for the many, many gifts of this beautiful and amazing community of faith. We thank you, and we ask you to come into us, breathe into us your love and your healing power. And we pray all these things in the name of Jesus, and all God's children say together, amen. All right, friends, you can go back to your seats now. Confirmands, you can stand up.
Oops. Our dinosaur had a trip up. I think it's a dinosaur. I wasn't clear. A dragon. How couldn't I know that? All right. Ben the magic dragon. Okay. Siblings in Christ, through the sacrament of baptism, we are initiated into Christ's holy church. We're incorporated into God's mighty acts of salvation and given new birth through water and the Spirit. All this is God's gift, offered to us without price. Through confirmation, we renew the covenant declared at our baptism. We acknowledge what God is doing for us, and we affirm our commitment to Christ's holy church. Today we celebrate our three confirmands who have been on a more in-depth journey of faith over the past year.
On behalf of our whole congregation, I present these persons for confirmation. And immediate families, when you hear your confirmand's name, you're invited to come and stand with them. Nick von Hindenburg, son of Anisha Abraham and Hannafred von Hindenburg, and his mentor is Carolyn Davis. And for Zachary Mule, son of Tracy Hogan and Greg Mule, and his mentor is Miss Josiane Blackman. And for William Tucker, son of Melissa Johns and Bill Tucker, and his mentor is Eric Lee.
See how we're making it work up here? That's amazing. Beautiful. All right. Nick, Zachary, and William. I'm going to make sure I'm... On behalf of the whole church, I now ask you, do you renounce the spiritual forces of wickedness, reject the evil powers of this world, and repent of your sin? If so, please say, I do.
I do.
Do you accept the freedom and the power that God gives you to resist evil, injustice, and oppression in whatever forms they present themselves? If so, please say, I do. Do you confess Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, put your whole trust in Christ's grace, and promise to serve Christ as your Lord in union with the church, which Christ has opened to people of all ages, nations, races, abilities, orientations, and gender identities? If so, please say, I do.
And to all of you worshiping here with us today and online, we invite you to respond as printed in your worship guide. Do you, as Christ's body, the church, reaffirm both your rejection of sin and your commitment to Christ?
We do.
Will you nurture one another in the Christian faith and life and include these persons now before you in your care?
With God's help, we will proclaim the good news and live according to the example of Christ. We will surround these persons with a community of love and forgiveness that they may grow in their trust of God and be found faithful in their service to others. We will pray for them that they may be true disciples who walk in the way that leads to life.
Continuing in your worship guide, let us join together now in professing the Christian faith as revealed in the scriptures of the Old and New Testaments. Do you believe in God the Creator?
I believe in God the Almighty, creator of heaven and earth.
Do you believe in Jesus Christ?
I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate,
was crucified,
died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven, is seated at the right hand of God, and will come again to judge the living and the dead.
Do you believe in the Holy Spirit?
I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. William, remember your baptism and be thankful. Nick, remember your baptism and be thankful. Zach, remember your baptism and be thankful. Beloved, according to the grace given to you by God, will you remain faithful members of Christ's holy church and serve as Christ's representatives in the world? If so, please say, I will. As members of Christ's universal church, will you be loyal through the United Methodist Church and do all in your power to strengthen its ministries? If so, please say, I will. And as members of Foundry United Methodist Church, will you faithfully participate in its ministries with your prayers, your presence, your gifts, your service, and your witness? If so, please say, I will.
As part of the confirmation process, our confirmands have prepared a statement of faith which represents the work and the learning that they have done in the past months, and they will share that with you now.
Pastor Ginger, our class worked together and would like to make some additional commitments as part of our confirmation at Boundary.
Amen.
First, we recognize the harm that has been caused in the United Methodist Church because of hate, division, and exclusion. We condemn injustice everywhere, but especially the actions that have been taken to solidify division in our denomination based on race, gender identity, and who people love. We condemn denominational policies that result in the denial and refusal of clergy of color, women clergy, and LGBTQIA+ clergy persons at every level.
We commit to continuing the work for justice for Indigenous peoples by amplifying Indigenous voices, encouraging meaningful connection to resources, and acknowledging that the land on which we gather is not our own. We commit to continuing the work of inclusion in the United Methodist Church to ensure that all people are welcomed into membership and leadership, regardless of their immigration status, their gender identity, or whom they love.
We commit to working for change even when the injustice doesn't affect us personally. We commit to showing up and offering our gifts of leadership to the youth group at protests and public witness events, and in worship by reading scripture and serving communion.
So I invite Nick to come and to kneel.
And any extended family that might want to come and join Nick.
You invite the family to come. Please lay hands on. Nick, may the Holy Spirit work within you, that being born through water and the Spirit, you may be a faithful disciple of Jesus Christ. Your mentor's prayer for you is that you continue to nurture your passions for helping others, asking big questions, and calling out injustice where you see it. By the grace of the Holy Spirit, let the people of God say together, Amen.
Amen.
Zach, we invite you and your family to come forward. There's your mentor. Yeah. Zach, may the Holy Spirit work within you, that being born through water and the Spirit, you may be a faithful disciple of Jesus Christ. Your mentor's prayer for you is that you grow in awareness of God's grace and in thankfulness for God's infinite blessings. Amen. Will. William, may Holy Spirit work within you that being born through water and the Spirit, you may be a faithful disciple of Jesus Christ. Your mentor's prayer for you is that you continue to think deeply about why you believe what you believe and stay connected to the part of you that wants to speak up for others. Mm-hmm. Let the people of God say together, Amen. Amen.
As we welcome our newest members, we invite you all to join us in responsive reading in the congregational blessing printed in your worship guide. Members of the household of God, I commend these persons to your love and care. Do all in your power to increase their faith, confirm their hope, and perfect them in love.
We give thanks for all that God has already given you, and we welcome you in Christian love. As members together with you in the body of Christ, and in this congregation of the United Methodist Church, we renew our covenant faithfully to participate in the ministries of the church by our prayers, our presence, our gifts, our service, and our witness, that in everything God may be glorified through Jesus Christ. I invite you to extend hands in a symbol of prayer and blessing as we pray our blessing upon these new confirmands. Beloved of God, may the God of all grace establish and strengthen you by the power of the Holy Spirit, that you might live all the days of your lives in grace, in peace, in courage, and with power. Amen.
Amen.
Will you join me in celebrating our confirmands? Friends, now we will turn to a time of prayer. Pastor Ben will lead us.
We're going to finish doing our little shuffle up here, if you don't mind. Thank you, Pastor Will. Pastor Casey, Pastor TC, Pastor Jim, everyone who is visiting, thank you for bearing with us and for joining in this wonderful moment of our day. We have prayed, we have sung, we have danced a little shuffle up here. And so now let us pray for and with one another. We invite you to hold, in addition to everything that you have brought on your own hearts, these concerns of our wider Foundry family. We continue to lift up prayers for Jean Poocher, for Frances Prince and her husband Norman, who is caring for her, for Leslie Kirk and for Joan Williams. We lift up prayers for Earlene Smith. We ask prayers for Jeff Smiley and the loss of his mother, Claudia Smiley. And we lift up prayers for Bob Gilliatt and his family. Bob has entered into hospice care. We pray for our confirmation class and will continue to pray for them, for Zach and William and for Nick. And we lift up our sibling congregations, John Wesley, AME Zion, and Asbury United Methodist Church, and all those congregations looking to be faithful in their response in this time of pandemic. Will you pray with me? Holy and loving God, whose spirit sweeps across the chaos to bring calm, breathe upon the earth once more to refresh and to strengthen all creation. Break through these walls and doors of our grief and our despair, to infuse life within and between your people. Teach our hearts and our tongues to once again understand and share the language of love and of grace and of mercy. Let our lives, led by a fiery compassion, a compassion burning enough to consume our distrust or our anger and our violence, let our lives be led by that compassion. We pray for healing, for body, for city, for nation and world, those places daily visited by violence. Recenter the voice of the hurting. May the powerful be healed in such a way that we can receive the cry of the needy, those evicted, buried under debt, and sitting at the margin, struggling for manna, the things needed for life. Break us down, that your justice might be built. Burn within us and within this nation and within this world that we would love one another as you have loved us. Holy God, we ask a lot, but we ask it to the one who can do this and abundantly more. With and through us, or moving right around us, we pray, may it be so, in Jesus' name. Amen.
As we continue worshiping together today, receive these words from the book of Acts, the second chapter, beginning with the first verse. When the day of Pentecost had come, they were all together in one place, and suddenly from heaven there came a sound like the rush of a violent wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting. Divided tongues, as of fire, appeared among them, and a tongue rested on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other languages as the Spirit gave them ability. Now there were devout Jews from every people under heaven living in Jerusalem. At this sound, the crowd gathered and was bewildered because each one heard them speaking in the native language of each. Amazed and astonished, they asked, "Are not all these who are speaking Galileans? And how is it that we hear, each of us, in our own native language? Parthians, Medes, Elamites, and the residents of Mesopotamia, Judea, and Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, Egypt, and the parts of Libya belonging to Cyrene, and visitors from Rome, both Jews and proselytes, Cretans and Arabs. In our own languages, we hear them speaking about God's deeds of power. All were amazed and perplexed, saying to one another, 'What does this mean?' But others sneered and said, 'They are filled with new wine.' And he testified with many other arguments and exhorted them, saying, 'Save yourselves from this corrupt generation.'" Receive what the Spirit is saying. Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Penda, for that reading. Before I say a very few words to introduce our guest preacher, who really doesn't need much of an introduction, I'm going to take one moment of personal privilege for those of us who are longtime members or short-time members of Foundry Church, and know I'm not skipping it. It's not going to happen. We have a member of our clergy team who has for many, many years stood with grace and strength and courage and power to serve the church, even in the face of rejection, in the face of hatred, in the face of all sorts of lies being spoken about her. And she has continued to bring herself forward as exactly who she is, married to a fabulous wife. And today we celebrate that on Friday, what God already had done years ago got confirmed by the United Methodist Church, and T.C. Morrow was ordained as a full member and ordained deacon in the United Methodist Church. Come up here, please. Come right here.
You're not going to say anything, but it's a better picture. Yeah.
We've got so much going on, it's going to be a brief prayer, but you can extend your hands. We're going to pray and say a blessing of thanksgiving and prayer for TC. Lord God, we give you thanks for your power and your grace and your strength and your mercy that has sustained TC and given her the ability and capacity to stand in your power and in your grace and to be such an amazing witness to sacred resistance, to faith and hope and love, and to a joy that truly shines through even in the midst of challenge. For these and all your many blessings, we give thanks and ask you to bless her and her family in this day and every day moving forward. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Friends, on page 4 of your worship guide, you will find a full biography of our guest preacher. And I'm not going to read all of it. What I'm going to say to you is that I'll just share this first little piece so that we're all clear. The Reverend Dr. William J. Barber is the president and senior lecturer of Repairers of the Breach, co-chair of the Poor People's Campaign, a national call for moral revival, bishop with the Fellowship of Affirming Ministries, visiting professor at Union Theological Seminary, and senior fellow at Auburn Seminary, and for more than a quarter century has also, you know, been a pastor of a church, the Greenleaf Christian Church Disciples of Christ in Goldsboro, North Carolina, from whence he launched, yeah, you got a few North Carolinians around the house today, from which he launched Moral Mondays and a gazillion other powerful, world-changing ministries and movements. And I encourage you to read every word and to continue to follow this amazing pastor and prophet for our time. We are blessed beyond measure to welcome today the Reverend William Barber II. The choir's going to sing.
I will live. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. All of my help comes from the Lord. God, we thank you today that every bit of our strength comes from thee. And we know whenever you call men and women to preach, you take the risk of putting treasure in trash, treasure in an earthen vessel, sometimes flawed and failing and weak, and yet you do it that the excellency of the power might be of thee and not of us. So hide us behind the cross. Cover us in your blood. Fill us with your spirit, that the words of our mouth and the meditation of our heart might be acceptable in thy sight. O Lord, our strength and blessed Redeemer. Amen. Let's thank God for this Pentecost Sunday, where Sophia is indeed pouring out on us today. Amen. Let me thank God for the angel of this house, Pastor Ginger. Would you join me? Let me thank God for the conferees who are the church today, not the church tomorrow. To our dear sister, our dear colleague in clergy and ministry, just confirmed and ordained, thank God for you today. Amen. Let me thank God for Pastor Alvin Jackson, the executive director of the Mass Moral March on Washington we're having, who is the reason I'm here today, through his connections with Pastor Ginger, one of the tremendous clerics of our time. And we thank God for him and love him indeed. I thank God for our co-chair of the Poor People's Campaign, the Reverend Dr. Liz Theo Harris, who is a preacher in her own right, to our National Director of Religion, Casimir Brown, Reverend Casimir Brown, who's an elder in the AME Church, the African Methodist Church. To all of the other team members, Ms. Charmaine Fletcher, who tries to keep me on schedule. You all pray for her. That is a hard job. Amen. She has to get a crown. To all of you who have gathered here today, as we say down south, if I missed anybody, charge it to my head and not to my... you from down south? Yes, that's right. I got to mention my counselor, though, Penda Hare. I didn't know she was a powerful liturgist and scripture reader. Where's Penda? There she is. Now, Mr. Mike, man, you just follow along. I'm from down south. It'll be all right. Amen. Amen. The Bible says when the day of Pentecost came, they were all together in one place. And then verse 40 says, with many other words, he warned them and he pleaded with them, save yourselves from this corrupt, untoward, as the King James, generation. I want to try for a moment this morning to talk about, it's time for a coming together meeting. It's time for a coming together meeting. And they were all on one accord. What does God call us to do in a world that will crucify love? What does God call us to do in a world that will lynch and kill justice, mercy, and grace? Even when you have seen resurrections and you've seen victories, but you're still existing in a world that will crucify love. That's the world that the apostles were in. They had seen it. They had not read about it. It was not some Gnostic imagination. They had seen the blood. They had heard the screams. They knew that they lived in a world where Jesus was crucified, because in the midst of Roman domination, he chose to stand with the least and the left out. They knew they were in a world where, even after the resurrection, the political systems of Herod and Caesar were still alive, and they were still thirsty for death, thirsty to put down any resistance to the empire. Jesus had been crucified. Because in the face of all the pomp and power of Roman domination that allowed religion, as long as it didn't challenge the state, as long as it didn't question Caesar, question Herod, as long as that religion didn't question the state of things, and yet Jesus questioned it with every prayer, with every action, with every healing, with every sermon. And it had crucified him. Jesus said that the priority of life ought to be love and not hate. The priority of life ought to be justice and not injustice. The priority of life ought to be lifting the poor and not catering to the greedy, and it got him killed. R. MacMullen, in his study of Roman culture titled Roman Social Relations, he noted that the aristocracy of ancient Rome continually reminded other people of their superior position. And they did it by always putting on display their conspicuous consumption, their entourages in the cities, their dress, their education, their title. And they insisted that the law discriminate positively in the favor of the aristocracy. Those of the decurions were exiled for capital crimes, while the other 99% of the population were crucified for capital crimes, fed to wild beasts, or forced to work in mines for much lesser crimes. The ruling class under the political system of Herod and Caesar looked down on those who earned a living by manual labor. Cicero described the majority of Roman society as sordos ubers et fox, the filth and the dregs of the city. Now think about how extraordinary it must have sounded to an audience in the Greco-Roman city for Jesus to begin his public ministry specifying beggars and heartbroken folk and bruised people and those not welcomed as the very interests of God and the primary recipients of the gospel. Those on the bottom of the social register were at the top of the mind of God. Think about it. In the very beginning of his sermon, in the very beginning of his ministry, you know, Jesus almost got killed at his first sermon. He said, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me. I'll preach good news to the poor." That word there, Pentacost, means those who've been made poor by systems of economic exploitation, recovery of sight to the blind, healing to the brokenhearted. He even said to declare the acceptable year of the Lord, to declare that everybody is acceptable, coming out of Isaiah 56. And the Bible says he preached that first sermon in the ghetto of Nazareth, where you would have thought it would have been a welcomed message. But by this time, the ghetto had been so deluded by Herod and Caesar that even the ghetto wasn't open to receiving the message of liberation. And so the Bible says that day they tried to kill him. In the middle of his ministry, he kept poor people and those on the margins at the center, feeding those others would let starve, healing those others would let die, touching those that others said, if you touch them, you bore their shame. And at the end of his ministry, as he was headed toward the cross, he was still declaring. Listen at him in Matthew 23, "Woe unto those who tithe and every little thing you have, but you leave undone the weightier matters of the law, which is justice." Listen to him as he's headed toward cross, Matthew 25. And the king will say to, and God will say to the nations, to the governments, "When I was hungry, did you feed me? When I was naked, did you clothe me? When I was an immigrant, did you welcome me?" And it got him killed. It got him killed. The systems of Herod and Pilate killed him. And now he's gone back to sit at the right hand of the Father, and he gives instructions, express instructions to his apostles. Go to Jerusalem and get together and stay there together on one accord until you receive power. And I wonder today, Pastor Ginger, if these instructions have any relevance for us today. Is this just old language, a cute, a nice story for 2,000 years ago? Do we still live in a world where some forces will still crucify love, crucify mercy, crucify justice? I would say yes. I would say that the greed and the injustice, like that of Herod and Caesar, is still alive. When I watch sometime Congress open and with prayer, and state legislatures open with prayer, and then after they pray, they pass laws that pray, P-R-E-Y, on the very people that God called on us to lift, I would suggest that the greed and injustice and the political spirit of Herod and Caesar still lives. When I'm reminded of what Coretta Scott King once said when she was asked about violence because her husband had been murdered, she said, "Well, that's not the only kind of violence." She said, "Violence is starving a child. Violence is not providing education. Violence is denying health care. Violence is denying labor rights and living wages." And then she said, "Even an apathetic attitude that refuses to address these other forms of violence is violence as well." I would suggest there's still a lot of violence there, and that the spirit of Herod and Caesar in many ways still lives. Liz and I saw this, experienced this in the United States Congress about 2 years ago when we took poor and low-wealth people of every race, creed, and color to testify before the budget committee. Liz and I both had on these stoles that said Jesus was a poor man. And we walked into the committee room, and as we began to testify, one of the congressmen got mad, raised his hands and said, all these people coming in here with these stoles on, it says Jesus was a poor man. He says, I've been a Christian all my life. And I've never seen in the word where Jesus challenged Caesar. To which I said, did you just compare yourself with Caesar? Because if you did, we have a bigger problem than I realized. But the fact of the matter is, he did. And that let us know that the politics of Herod and Caesar still lives. The greed and justice of Herod and Caesar still lives. The forces that will try to put down movements for justice still live. I wish it were not so. But that, Dr. Jackson, the data bears it out that we must hear the message of Pentecost, because the spirit of Herod and Caesar in many ways still live. When we know from studies that there are 140 million poor and low wealth people in this country today, 52% of all of our children, 60% of all black people, 26 million people, 45% of all women, 74 million women, 42% of all men, 65 million men, 64% of Latinos, 38 million, 40% of Asian, 8 million, 58% of Native indigenous people, 2.1 million, and 33% of white people, 66 million people. When I can come here today from the Southlands, but I have to report to you, even now, in the former Confederate states, there are 52 million people are poor and low income, almost half and half white and black, over 13 million people in the so-called Bible Belt are uninsured and have politicians that are representing them that fight against them having health care. The greed and the injustice of Caesar and Herod still lives. When the data says that there are 400 people in this country today that make an average of $97,000 an hour, and three people had more money than the bottom 50% of all Americans combined, while at the same time, low-wage workers who just want $15 an hour get arrested in our streets, I would declare that the spirit of Herod and Caesar still lives. When 62 million workers make less than a living wage, 53% of all black workers and CEOs make 300 times more than their average worker. Think about it. In 2021, 49 Republicans passed the agenda and two Democrats voted no. In the middle of a pandemic, in the middle of economic downturn, they voted no to raise the minimum wage to $15 an hour. In essence, saying to 52 million workers, you don't matter. You don't need a higher living wage. If you make $12,800 a year, you're not poor. In essence, told them that it was okay not to have raised the minimum wage for 12 years. It's at $7.25. And for restaurant workers, it's only $2.13. When you know the data, it'll make you very clear that the greed and injustice of Herod and Caesar still lives. 87 million people in this country who are uninsured or underinsured. People who have to pray not to get sick, because they can't afford the treatment. And even in the midst of COVID, we couldn't bring ourselves to at least provide everybody health care. We are one of the wealthiest countries in the world, 25 wealthiest countries in the world. The only one that is exceptional in not providing health care of some sort is the United States. And pastors like Pastor Ginger, sometimes we have to stand over people and preach their funerals. And the truth of the matter is, it wasn't their time to die. They were killed by policies that cut their lives short. 4 million people can get up every morning in this country and buy unleaded gas and can't buy unleaded water. The spirit of greed and injustice still lives. We spend 54 cents of every discretionary dollar on the war economy and less than 15 cents on education and healthcare and infrastructure. The spirit of greed and injustice still lives. Billionaires made $2 trillion so far during COVID, while 8 million more people fell into poverty during COVID. The spirit of greed still lives. And even before COVID hit, 700 people were dying a day from poverty. From poverty. 250,000 people dying a year from poverty. 7 people died from vaping, and we had a congressional hearing and presidential meetings. 700 people dying a day from poverty, and not a whimper, not a word in our political debates, in our political discussions. And then on top of that, all of this death, this fetish with guns and blood and killing. Yes, Buffalo, yes, Texas. But in addition to that, 213 mass deaths already this year. The spirit of greed, when you love a gun more than you love your children. The spirit of Herod and the spirit of greed and the spirit of Caesar and the spirit of domination still lives. The Economic Policy Institute says if we're going to come back from COVID, we need $10 trillion over the next 10 years, $1 trillion a year. But we live in a time when we couldn't even have an honest discussion about $1.9 trillion over 10 years. That's what the president put forward. We thought it was a step, but it certainly was not the journey. It certainly should have been more. He said, look, we want to talk about expanding and enhancing child income tax credit and universal pre-care and climate investment and clean energy and expanding Medicaid. And the first word out of folks' mouths, he said, let's reduce premiums for affordable care, let's expand Medicare, let's put some money in affordable housing and rental assistance and investment for elder care. And the first word out of the opposition was, no! How much does it cost? When Joseph Stiglitz said that's the wrong question, the Nobel Peace Prize economist, he said that's the wrong question. The question we should be asking is how much does it cost for us not to address these issues? The spirit of Caesar and Herod still lives. Whenever we start conversations in this country with the lie about scarcity, whenever there's an attempt to address poverty and always the issue is how much does it cost, but when there's a discussion about funding the military or there's a discussion about tax cuts for the wealthy, that never comes up. The spirit of Herod and injustice and greed still lives. And do you know, my brothers and sisters, child poverty cost us $1 trillion a year in lost economic productivity, increased health and crime costs? Do you know that we've lost $328 billion being pumped in the economy because we wouldn't raise the federal minimum wage to $15? And by the way, when Dr. King was here in 1963, the March on Washington was not just a march about fellowship, it was a march for jobs and justice. And the agenda then was a $2 minimum wage indexed with inflation would be $15 today. Do you know that unstable housing among families with children will cost the United States $111 billion in avoidable health costs? Do you know that a hunger costs $160 billion a year in increased healthcare costs? and another $18 billion in poor educational outcomes. Do you know that public assistance programs spend $153 billion a year as a direct result of low wages? Do you know our broken immigration system cost us $123 billion in lost contribution? Our current healthcare system cost individuals $1.69 trillion on private insurance and out-of-pocket expenses, and countless avoidable deaths. One study said for every 500,000 people that are denied healthcare, some 2,800 die every year. Do you know that inaction on climate change is estimated to eventually cost our economy $3.3 trillion every year? Do you know that our government has spent $21 trillion on war and militarizing our borders since 2001? Do you know that even if our current military budget was cut in half, we would still have more money than Iran, Iraq, China, and Russia combined? Do you know that our government lost $1.3 trillion by lowering the corporate tax rate from 35% to 21%? All of these things let me know that the spirit of greed, the spirit of injustice, and the spirit of Herod, and the spirit of Caesar still live. I wish it was not so, but the data bears it out. And so the question is, does Pentecost have a message for us as we face the oppressive realities of our day, the realities that still crucify the soul and crucify dreams and cause people to die? Because every regressive piece of public policy has a death measurement attached to it. Yes, it does. Pentecost has something to say to us. Jesus left his disciples clear instructions. You must have a coming together. You must have a coming together meeting and receive power in order to stand up to the realities that exist. He says, in essence, with all your differences, you got to put them aside, and you have to come together in a meeting with one purpose, and that is to be a countercultural reality to the lies of Herod and Caesar. And if you come together, you shall receive power. And I declare that with all we see today, there must be a coming together meeting. If we ever needed a moral Pentecost, we need it right now. And we must say to America, America needs that message of Pentecost. Save yourselves. Save this democracy from all this greed and all these lies and all this violence. You've got a chance to save yourselves. The truth of the matter is, my brothers and sisters, it's all right to come in here in the sanctuary, but when I read Pentecost, they went in the streets and they decided that they wouldn't be silent or unseen anymore. We must have a coming together meeting. We must offer a way to save the soul of the nation and build power. And we must understand that there's a lot that the enemy has done to divide us. Did you know that in 1965, at the end of the Selma to Montgomery March, Dr. King said that the great fear of the aristocracy was for the masses of poor Negroes and the masses of poor white folk to get together to form a new political bloc that would fundamentally shift the economic architecture of the nation. He said that at the end of the Selma to Montgomery March, he understood that the power is in us getting together. Did you know that there was a strategy put in place? The tactics were put in place when Kevin Phillips and Lee Atwater, and they picked it up. It was continued by folk like Reagan and others. Recent President Trump charismatized it, pushed it. But the strategy is old. Kevin Phillips advised Nixon in 1968 how to win. He said, what we've got, and they said, the way we win is we have to engage in positive polarization. Listen to me now. This is anti-Pentecost. They said what we have to do is engage in positive polarization. We have to use the people's anger over the women's movement, over the civil rights movement, over the LGBT movement, and split people one from another. Jonathan Schell, in his book, The Time of Illusion, wrote that Buchanan said, we've got to cut the country in half. And if we can cut the country in half, we will pick the better half. And we can do it in the South, but we can also do it throughout the North. And then Harry Dent said to Nixon, you've got to use racially coded language strong enough to persuade people that Wallace is too mean, but that their feelings are right. You have to use coded language so that it comes across smooth. But you convince people that other people are an endangerment to them. And he said, and when they find out that we're using this plan, we've got to disavow it publicly. And the same politicians that divided once they get elected, they use their power to block living wages, to block health care, and to treat corporations like people and people like things. And that's why we must have in this moment a moral Pentecost. It's time, y'all. It's time for a moral Pentecost. It's time for a coming together meeting. When we know that if we raise the minimum wage to $15, 42 million people will come up out of poverty, it's time. It's time. When we know that if we provide health care for everybody, people will live who right now are dying, it's time. It's time. We can't be silent anymore. It's time for a coming together meeting. It's time for a moral Pentecost where we demand that our policies and our politics and our laws and our legislation first centers and prioritizes the poor and those at the bottom. Because if you lift from the bottom, then everybody rises. It's time. It's time. We can't be silent anymore. It's time that we demand that when we cut out this foolishness of talking about, are you on the left, or are you on the right, or are you on the conservative, or are you liberal? What about, are you establishing justice? What about, are you providing for the common defense? What about, are you promoting the general welfare of all people? What about, are you ensuring equal protection under the law for everybody? Turn this mic up some. What about? It's time for a coming together meeting. In other words, children got to be saved, it's time. Sick folk got to be insured and healed, it's time. Low-wage workers got to be paid, it's time. Housing for all must be provided, it's time. The atmosphere and the environment must be saved, it's time. Indigenous people must be treated right, it's time. Immigration reform and welcoming our brothers and sisters, it must be done, it's time. Voting rights must be expanded and protected, it's time. Spending more money to blow up the world than to save the world must be stopped, it's time. Using religion to justify hurt and evil must be challenged. It's time. We've got to have a coming together meeting. Gotta have one. And if the shock of COVID hasn't revived the heart of this nation, and we can be all right with a million people dying and poor people dying at a rate of two to five times higher than everybody else, then what we need is not a shock to the heart. We got to have a heart transplant. And in order to have a heart transplant, we've got to have a moral Pentecost. It's time for a coming together meeting. Because the actions of too few are hurting too many. We must come together. We can't and we won't be silent anymore. And when we have come together in meetings, in God's name, God has a way of sending fire. When you come together in God's name, He sends the fire of illumination and the fire of inspiration. When you come together in God's name, He sends a fresh wind. You thought you was tired, but then a fresh wind comes and blows you into a new direction. When you come together in God's name, He'll give you brand new tongues for truth telling and love telling and grace telling and mercy telling. And He'll give you a tongue that won't be silent anymore. It's time for a coming together meeting. Oh, and let me close by telling you every time that God orchestrates a coming together meeting, something happens. There were all through the Bible, when at the very beginning, the earth was void and without form. And then God had a coming together meeting. And He said, let us make man, let us make humanity. And there was a coming together meeting. When it looked like there was no way out down at the Red Sea, God had a coming together meeting. And when it was all over, the split sea was open. And then Pharaoh was drowned in the sea. When Goliath was boasting and warring, God called a coming together meeting between David and five rocks in the valley. And when it was all over, we found out the bigger they are, the harder they fall. When things were bleak and bad and injustice was all around, God called a coming together meeting in the valley of dry bones. And when they came together, they became the hope and the possibility of a new reality. When Shadrach, Meshach, and some folks say that bad Negro faced annihilation in the furnace, God called a coming together meeting. And the Son of God showed up in the fire, and they came out, and they didn't even have the smell of smoke on them. When hunger was hurting people, God called a coming together meeting and fed 5,000 with some fish and some loaves. When Jesus died on the cross, God called a coming together meeting. And the prophets that had been dead a long time ago started getting up all around Jerusalem. When God called a coming together meeting, something always happens. In 1852, after the Dred Scott decision, when it looked like the abolition movement was over, God called a coming together meeting. God called a Pentecost, and white abolitionists and black abolitionists, they got together and brought slavery down. And then even more, when women needed their rights, God called a coming together meeting, and black women and white women came together. Sojourner Truth and Lucretia Mott and Seneca Falls. In the early 1900s, there were no labor laws. Greed was destroying workers. And then God called a coming together meeting between the social gospel movement and the labor movement. And that's how we got labor laws. When black men were being lynched on an average of one per day, God called a coming together meeting and got Ida B. Wells and W.B. Boyce and other white allies to join in. When people weren't being paid in the middle of the Depression, God called a coming together meeting. The bonus marchers, they got together and they demanded that people get paid right. When there was Jim Crow in the land and it was all legal, God called a coming together meeting, and black men and women and white men and women and Jewish men and women and lawyers, they got together and they tore separate but equal down. When Emmett Till was killed, God called a coming together meeting. Rosa Parks and Martin Luther King got together and say, you kill one Emmett Till, we kill your whole system of Jim Crow. God called a coming together meeting. At the lunch counter in Greensboro, God called a coming together meeting. In Birmingham, with less than 40 people at the beginning, God called a coming together meeting. At Selma on the Edmund Pettus Bridge, God called a coming together meeting. And every time God called a coming together meeting, a moral Pentecost, something happened. In California with farm workers, Cesar Chavez, God used him to have a coming together meeting. And all these meetings brought power. All these meetings brought transformation. All these meetings brought change. All these meetings brought a revolution. I'm here to tell you, it's time for a coming together meeting. Hallelujah. America needs a coming together meeting. Are y'all going to join us on June 18th for a coming together meeting? Hallelujah. Pastor Ginger, I'm trying to stop preaching because I know about coming together biblically and I know about coming together historically, but I need to tell you about coming together personally and what God can do when we come together. In 1993, I was told I might never walk again. I was told it all over for me. I was told I might have to be in a nursing home. I was told that my body wouldn't work anymore. I was told that ankylosing had destroyed my hip roses. But then God called a coming together meeting. My doctors got together. My therapists got together. The prayer warriors at the church got together. My faith got together. My swim coach got together. I can't run, but I can hop now. I can still stand now because God called a coming together meeting. I serve a God that can still call a Pentecost meeting. So there's only one thing left to ask. Are you going to be at the meeting? Will you help us have a meeting? Will you go home and bring folk to the meeting? Because if we have a meeting, God will help us. If we have a meeting, God will visit us. If we have a meeting, we can turn this nation around. When I was in the old church down south, they used to sing, I want to be at the meeting. I want to be at the meeting. I want to be at the meeting round the throne after the separating of the right from the wrong. Well, I don't want to go to heaven yet, but on June 18, I want to be at the meeting. I want to be at the meeting when black folks stand up and white folks stand up and Latino folks stand up and Asian folks stand up and indigenous folks stand up and gay folks stand up and straight folks stand up and Muslim people stand up and Jewish people stand up and Christian people stand up and all of us stand up and we call for a moral Pentecost in America. It's time. It's time. It's time for a coming together meeting. Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, will you meet me at the meeting? God is up to something, and I want to be at the meeting.
Be there. Y'all better be there. Thank you so much, Bishop Barber, for that prophetic word and that inspiration. We are so blessed. Friends, my name is Kehlani Wilbanks, and I serve as the Executive Director of Operations and Impact. We give thanks especially today for the gifts of this community that enables us to care for one another at every step of the faith journey. We give thanks for our confirmands and their families and their mentors. Your tithes and your gifts and your offerings care for confirmation in all of our growing family ministries. Friends, you can give online if you're worshiping with us online. You can give in at the links that are going to be showing up in the chat. If you are here with us in the sanctuary, our ushers will be at the back at the close of our worship time together to collect your gifts. Let's pray. Gracious and loving and generous God, we commit to showing up to that meeting. We give generously, we give faithfully. We offer up these gifts in the precious and holy name of Jesus. Amen.
Beloved, Christ our Lord invites to this table all who love God, who seek to live in peace with one another and repent of their sins.
Therefore, let us confess our sins before God and one another, praying the prayer of confession that we can find in our worship guide. Merciful God, We confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Beloved, receive the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love for us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Glory to God. Amen. As a forgiven and reconciled people, you are invited to rise as you are able and share greetings of peace and reconciliation with those around you.
Friends, we invite you to remain risen at the beginning and end of our great Thanksgiving, and once in the middle, we'll be singing together from Psalm 25. Our cantor, Kathleen, will lead us. She's going to teach us that song now, and then will guide us as we move.
Also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks. It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Almighty God, Creator of heaven and earth. In the beginning, your Spirit moved over the face of the waters. When we turned away and our love failed, your love remained steadfast. Your Spirit came upon prophets and teachers, anointing them to speak your word. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and sing.
To you, O God, I lift up my soul.
Holy are you, and blessed is Jesus Christ, who called you Abba, Father. As a mother tenderly gathers her children, you embraced a people as your own and filled them with a longing for a peace that would last and for a justice that would never fail. In Jesus' suffering and death, you took upon yourself our sin and death and destroyed their power forever. You raised from the dead this same Jesus, who now reigns with you in glory, and poured upon us your Holy Spirit, making us the people of your new covenant.
On the night before meeting with death, Jesus took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, and gave it to those gathered, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And when the supper was over, Jesus took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to the disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me."
And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us, as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
And so we are bold to pray that you would pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts, that in the breaking of this bread and the drinking of this cup, we may know the presence of the living Christ and be renewed as the body of Christ for the world redeemed by Christ's blood. By your Spirit at work in us, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory, love, and justice, and we feast together at the heavenly banquet. Through Christ, with Christ, and in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. And let the people of God say with one voice, Amen. Friends, you may be seated. As those who are coming to help serve and celebrate communion today with us do so, we want you to know that this table is a table open to all God's people, a source of strength and a reminder of God's living grace from generation to generation. All of you, no matter who you are or how you've come, are welcome to receive the goodness of God that is prepared for us here. Our ushers will guide you today to one of the stations here at the front or back of our sanctuary or in our balcony, where you'll be invited to receive a piece of bread and then the cup for communion, to lower your mask and then to consume those elements. There'll be trash receptacles at each station where you can dispose of the cup when you're finished. If you are in need or would prefer pre-bagged elements today or gluten-free elements, there is a station here at the front of the sanctuary where the piano is located. You're invited to let one of the ushers know and they'll help make sure you get to where you need to go. And friends, if you'd simply like a blessing this day, all you have to do is come forward and cross your arms, and one of our pastors or stewards will pray with you. Beloved, the table has been prepared, and all is ready. Come now and taste and receive the goodness of our God.
Lift up my spirit.
Will you please join me in the prayer of thanksgiving as printed in your worship guide? Eternal God, we give you thanks for this holy mystery in which you have given yourself to us. Grant that we may go into the world in the strength of your Spirit to give ourselves for others. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Now, friends, I invite you to rise as you are able and join us in singing our final hymn, number 89 in the United Methodist Hymnal, Joyful, Joyful, We Adore Thee.
God has called a meeting today. How about that? We've been called to a meeting today, thanks be to God, and we give thanks to God for that. I want to remind you the parking garage at Colonial Parking around this corner closes at 2 today, so keep that in mind as you make your way out. We have ministers of prayer available here at the front of the sanctuary to pray with you today. So if there's something on your heart or mind, please come and receive that blessing, and the rest of us will try to hold and create sacred space for that ministry. And finally, remember we have our Power to the Polls pop-up to share, yes. So come on round and help give support to that. If nothing else, stop by and get your picture taken. We want to show how the support from Foundry for this effort with the Washington Interfaith Network. So please do stop outside and do that before you head out. I want to say give us another opportunity to say thank you and invite Bishop Barber to send us forth. Can we say thank you?
Thank you so much for welcoming all of us in this space. And as we head toward June 18th, the Mass Poor People's Low Wage Workers Assembly and Moral March on Washington, it is not a day, it's a declaration. It's not a day where a bunch of people will talk on behalf of poor and low wealth people, but where the people themselves will be put forward. That's the kind of meeting That's the kind of moral Pentecost, where we will challenge the systemic evils of racism, poverty, ecological devastation, denial of health care, the war economy, and the false moral narrative of religious nationalism and white supremacy. Call everybody you know. Text everybody you know. Email everybody you know. And invite them to come to the meeting. God works in community. God calls us to community. God empowers us in community. My benediction is strange this morning. I was brought to tears yesterday. I was on a whirlwind of barnstorming tour from Newark to Lancaster and back, Liz and I. And the reason I keep getting up every morning and refusing to quit was because of stories like this. There was a lady in Newark. And she could hardly walk. She said, "Pastor Barber, we gotta have this meeting. I don't have $10. And I want to give it to you to use to help somebody get there. I can't come." And I said, "Ma'am, you don't have to." She says, "No, I have to do this." She said, "Because all of us got to do our part to call the kind of moral meeting that's needed in America and in the world so bad, if we have any chance for change to come." She said, "They may not listen, but we gotta give the country a chance. So you take this money." And she folded it up and she put it in my hand. "All I got is $10. But I want you to use it to help somebody come to the meeting. My sending forth is to you today. My benediction is, don't look down, look up. Look forward. Go where God is sending us. God is already there waiting on us. And the God we serve, she will do great things. She will birth great things if we have the courage to have the meeting. Now unto the God who is able to keep us from falling, present this faultless before God's glory with exceeding joy. To the only wise God, our Savior, be glory, majesty, dominion, and power, both now, right now, henceforth, and forevermore. Amen."